blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Sing my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now on my side, angels descending, rain from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story. This is my story. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story. My song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day. This is my song.
God, you're so good. Amazing love, I know it's true. Yes, it's time for Sunday school. Good morning, church. This morning, this Good Friday morning, we will spend some time reflecting on the seven utterances, the seven sayings of Jesus when he was suspended on that cross. The first of which is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I'm sure all of you are very familiar with this saying, this text. Let us first reflect on the events preceded these sayings when Jesus was on that cross. Blindfolded, ridiculed, slapped by members of the Sanhedrin, spat upon, scourged. And if there is a distinct difference between being scourged and being whipped. If you know, being scourged means you use a whip that has sharp stones and lead. And if you watch The Passion of the Christ, you all do know what a harrowing experience that would have been. This was our Lord suspended on that cross. And certain historical accounts go on to say that he was so disfigured that Mary could barely recognize which one Jesus was. That is, in fact, supported by the account in Isaiah, where it says that his shape was so marred and unlike a form from the sons of men. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Jesus says his words, he addresses God as Father with all sincerity, an intercession on behalf of those who were committing this, who were doing this to him. That alone shows the love that Jesus had for us, even in that most agonizing of moments. A sincere plea on behalf of mankind. Forgive them. What does it mean to forgive? The Greek word for forgive or forgiveness is aphiemi. The basic meaning is send away, but it is often used at the time in certain commercial terms or legal terms to say, to release from legal or moral obligation, or consequence, cancel, remit, or pardon. Who was Jesus referring to when he said, forgive them? Was it the Romans, those mocking him? This gracious act of forgiveness, in fact, stretched back to the beginning of the first fallen couple and stretches forward right into generations to come, covering you and me. Church, today, you and I, and most of us, wear a cross. We have a cross in our houses to remind us of this unparalleled gift, this unparalleled sacrifice made on that cross. What do we take from that, church? Let us take that into our daily lives, how we apply it. If Jesus could go through all that, and in fact it was a sacrifice from God himself, manifested, and that came to being through the spilling of the blood of Jesus. This morning, as we go into the service and as we go back home, let us reflect on that sacrifice. In turn, let us see how we can also freely forgive those who transgress against us, those who are also not knowing of what they do in other senses of the word, be it in work, in personal life. Let us take that into our lives and apply it. Thank you. No clapping, it's church.
Good morning, church. The gospel according to Luke chapter 23 and from verse 32 onwards. And there were two others that were led with Jesus to be put to death. And when they came to the place called Calvary, there they crucified Jesus and the two thieves, the one on the left and the other on the right. One of the thieves hanging beside Jesus coughed him and said, "If you are the Messiah, save yourself and us." But the other thief said, "Don't you fear God even when you are sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he turned to Jesus and said, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus was crucified on the Mount Calvary with one thief on his left and the other on the right. One thief scoffed Jesus and said, "If you are the Messiah, save yourself and us." He wanted just to come down from the cross and go about doing what he was already doing, that was to be a robber. He also did not understand that Jesus was the Messiah who came to save the whole world. Because he said, "Save yourself." Jesus did not come to save himself. 1 Timothy 1:5 says, "Jesus came into the world to save sinners." John tells us in John 1:29, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." The Old Testament was a foreshadow of things to come. In Genesis 22, Abraham was asked to offer Isaac, his son, as a sacrifice. You mean to tell me that Isaac could not overpower 100-year-old Abraham and save himself? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was a willing sacrifice. The first thief got it all wrong. Hebrews 12 and verse 2 says, "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross." The hymn writer Ray Overholt says, "He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died for you and me." The second thief realized he deserved death for his crimes. Romans 3 and verse 23 says, "We all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom." He realized that he was a sinner in need of a savior. And that is why he said, "Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom." to him, Jesus was not just Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. To him, Jesus Christ was King of all kings. And that is why he said, to your kingdom. As the hymn writer Elvina Hall says, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but his blood washed me white as snow. And to that, Jesus replied, today you will be with me in paradise. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 8 says, we are confident of this, to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. Do you have that assurance that if you close your eyes here on earth, that you will be open your eyes in the presence of the Lord? Maybe you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart and to be Lord of your life. Today is the day of salvation. Ask him to cleanse you of your sins, and you too will be in paradise. John chapter 14, Jesus tells us, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go and prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. You will be in paradise. And as the hymn writer George Bernard says, then he'll call me one day to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. And I end by saying 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Amen.
As we collect the offering at this time, I would like to invite you to rise as we go into this song, Remembrance.
Your promise.
took salvation's role with fear and trembling. Your way born as my own, as Christ is formed in me.
So the Bible verse is, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. So in this verse, Jesus was referring to his mother, who was Mary, and John, who was the disciple whom he loved. And at this point, as you all saw in that video, Jesus is bearing down all the sins of the world, all the pain, all the suffering of the world, and he is going to die for our sins. But it's very interesting to see that he, in this moment of all that suffering, he chooses to say this. And what I'm about to do is to just get a bit into that for the next few minutes. So from John, who wrote this this gospel, he says in the beginning of his gospel, he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he was in the beginning with God." So the Greek word that John uses here to describe Jesus, God, is the word logos. So logos, according to Greek philosophers, is the power that puts sense into the world, making the world orderly instead of chaotic. The logos was the power that set the world in perfect order and kept it going in perfect order. And they saw logos as the ultimate reason for control above all things. Now, if Jesus was this logos that John is referring to at the start of his gospel, why does he choose to say this at the point of his suffering? I believe that Jesus was trying to teach us something through the moment of suffering rather than the act of the suffering itself. And if you think about it, the night before he was supposed to be betrayed, he tells his disciples, "One of y'all here are going to betray me." He says to Peter that he will deny him 3 times. So in contrast to those things, to say something so simple as "take care of my mother," John, the night before, why did he have to say it on the cross? Why couldn't he have said it the night before? He said something, think about it. He's telling someone he's going to betray him. He's telling someone that one of them are going to deny him 3 times. But he can't say something so simple as, "Take care of my mother tomorrow, from tomorrow onwards." So, if you, in Matthew chapter 22, verse 38 to 40, where Jesus gives us the commandments, he says, "Thou shalt love the Lord with all thy heart, all thy soul, and all thy mind." And then the second commandment he gives is, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these 2 commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So when Jesus says hang all the law and the prophets he's referring to here is the Hebrew Bible. So he's saying that these 2 commandments are the core and fundamental values of the Hebrew Bible. He's saying everything here stands on the Bible, the Hebrew Bible at that time, stands on these 2 commandments. And then in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, he says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets," which is the Hebrew Bible. "I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled." One jot means the horizontal line in a T, and a tittle could be the dot in the letter I. He's saying that not a single thing will pass away within what is said in the word. And what we see here is God fulfilling those 2 commandments, fulfilling those 2 commandments from the fundamental values of the Hebrew Bible, when he's loving his God with all his heart and all his soul and all his mind. On that cross, he's bearing all the pain of the world, loving his God, doing it out of love. And at the same time, he's doing things to others as he would have them do unto you. That's through himself, So he's thinking about Mary in that moment of suffering. He's looking at her and thinking, if I was in her shoes, what would I need? I need someone to take care of me. My husband is passed away. At the same time, he's loving his God and being the ultimate sacrifice. And he's fulfilling what he said he will do at the start. And he's fulfilling the main two commandments of the Bible. So that is what Jesus, I felt as though Jesus was trying to teach us through that.
Matthew chapter 27, verses 45 to 46. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" So it's midday, usually the time when the sun shines the brightest. But on this particular day, we find that there is darkness over all the land. And obviously with darkness comes chaos, fear. And at the foot of the cross, there is a lot of activity going on. The Bible says in Genesis that when Adam and Eve sinned on that first day, or in Genesis, we find that the consequence of sin was eternal separation from God. We also find that in Genesis itself, when this sin takes place, God comes up with a plan to reconcile man and God, because God, who created man, did not want to be separated from man. So during this dark time, we find a transaction being taken place. Unknown to people who were around the cross, this plan that was made was put into action. The sins of the world, or sins of mankind, was taken from man and put upon Jesus. So Jesus was going to bear the load of sin of mankind. This gave us, you and me, freedom to come before God boldly. Verse 51 of that same chapter talks about the curtain, a curtain that blocked man to come to the Holy of Holies. And verse 51 says that this curtain that was blocking man was torn from top to bottom, signifying the fact that we could now come to God without any worry. We didn't need to carry our guilt. We didn't need sacrifices. We could now come before God without shame or fear. But what was it for Jesus? Jesus was taking the sin of the world, which meant that now the separation that God and man had is now going to be upon him. And so he is now separated from his Father. This is the first and only time we find that Jesus and God are separated. And so, Jesus, being a human being at that time, would have been at the lowest point of his life. He was forsaken by his friends the night before. He was left alone. He was bruised. And now, the only hope he had of clinging on to God was also lost. And so we find these words, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, didn't Jesus know all this? Because when God made this plan, obviously Jesus was there. So obviously Jesus knew that he was going to get separated from God. Then why did Jesus ask such a question? Was it that Jesus felt defeated? Was it that Jesus felt that there was no hope? Looking at scripture, we find that Jesus is actually quoting scripture. And in Psalm 22, a psalm written by King David, talks of the same thing. Starts by saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And you realize when you read this psalm that Jesus is actually quoting scripture. And if you go through that psalm, Psalm 22, you find that David is in a very, very low situation. He's in a dark place. He's carrying a heavy load. And he is asking God, why have you forsaken me? But if you go through the psalm, and as it proceeds, you realize that David doesn't just stop there. He moves on. He looks at God, and he looks at the faithfulness of God. And he looks at the victory that God is going to give him right at the end. He saw the bigger picture. He understood who God was. And Jesus was the same. Jesus was reminding himself that it is going to be a victorious end. How do you feel today, this morning? Are you carrying a burden? Is your life in a dark position? Have you been calling out to God and you feel that God is not answering you? Do you think that you come to the end of the road? Let's take David and Jesus as an example. My challenge is that we look to God today. You look at God's faithfulness. Look back in your life. Look at what the Lord has done for you. He's always been faithful, and he will bring us to victory. Remember that God loves us, and that's why he hung on the cross. And he has a plan for each of us. The plan he's talking about is a good and victorious plan, not a plan of defeat. Our plan in our lives is part of his big plan. So my prayer is today that we move on from where we are. Look forward and look at the victorious end. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. So the verse that I have to share is from John 19:28, as we just saw. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Have you ever been in a situation in your life where you were feeling overwhelmed, where you were feeling anxious, where you were feeling tired, exhausted, drained? Have you ever been in a situation or an event or a phase where you were feeling hurt? Where you were feeling pain, whether that be mentally, emotionally, physically? Have any of you here felt discouraged? Have you felt depressed? Have you felt sad? Have you felt like you've been let down? You might have just thought of a situation in your life where you experienced these emotions or some of these emotions in the past. You might actually be experiencing this right now. Let me tell you that Jesus experienced the same. Do you as a Christian feel as though you are doing everything right, that you are praying, that you are worshiping, that you are doing and being exactly what God wants you to do and be, yet the trials, they still exist, the pain, it still exists, and sometimes it's a lot to take, and you wonder why you have to go through it, you ask God why, and you might even wonder where God is. Jesus went through the same. The scripture that John is referring to in this verse is in Psalm 69. And although the psalm is attributed to David, it is written about a righteous man who endures suffering. And so scholars believe that this was written about Jesus as the righteous sufferer. So ideally we should read the whole psalm, but I'll read from verse 1 to 4. It says, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. Deeper and deeper I sink into the mire. I can't find a foothold. I am in deep water, and the floods overwhelm me. I am exhausted from crying for help. My throat is parched. My eyes are swollen with weeping, waiting for my God to help me." In your situations, have you felt that you couldn't take it anymore? That you couldn't bear it any longer? That the waters were rising up all around you? That you couldn't keep doing and doing, and that your energy had run out, and that your throat was parched or dry? Jesus felt the same. Think for a second of all of those situations, all of those trials that you have experienced in your lifetime. Imagine experiencing all of that pain at once, at one point in time. Jesus did. And he didn't just experience one individual's lifetime of pain, he experienced everyone's lifetime of pain. He bore all of it. Have you, in these situations, have you looked around you for help? Have you looked for comfort, for solutions? Have you looked for someone or something to ease the pain? Jesus did. In Psalm 69, verse 19 to 21, it says, "You know how I am scorned, disgraced, and shamed. Scorn has broken my heart and has left me helpless. I looked for sympathy, but there was none. I looked for comforters, but I found none. They put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst." Coming back to that verse in John 19, 28, we hear that Jesus says, "I thirst." And we can really see that God became human, God became flesh. And he cried out, "I thirst," after bearing all of that pain, even as Uncle Ajit just shared. And the verse soon after that, we can see that they soaked a sponge in sour wine or in vinegar, and they gave it to him to drink. Now, in this crucifixion story, this was the second instance where Jesus was offered sour wine to drink, and in the second instance, he took it. Wine vinegar or sour wine in the Old Testament was often given as a common refreshing drink. The first instance mentioned in Matthew and Mark was when Jesus arrived at Golgotha. He was offered wine mixed with myrrh or gall. And this combination was offered by Romans to those who were being crucified as sort of a drug. Some places refer to it as a poison or a drug to dull or numb the pain. And in that first instance, Jesus refused to drink it. He chose to bear the pain. He chose to bear the pain for you and me. The solutions that the world has to offer to your pain, to your situations, might sometimes be like that sour wine. There might be substances to numb your pain. There might be solutions that give you temporary relief. And there might be some, these might provide some form of answer, but for the time being. But does it really, truly satisfy your thirst? So then what do? Jesus tells us in John chapter 4, and Jesus tells the Samaritan woman, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." So as Jesus says and did, we need to look to God. Jesus showed us that he came down to earth, he became human, he became flesh, he bore all of that pain, all of that suffering to give us direct access to God. Jesus gave us direct access to that source of living water. So in our situations and in our pain, we don't need to look to the world for solutions. So let's remember to look to God and to be filled with that eternal living water.
Shall we rise, church?
thirsty, panted for the water, so my soul longs after thee. For you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You're my friend, you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Precious is the flow that
I know personally, we start to fast or pray, or there are things that we start to do but we never finish. So today I want to talk about what Jesus said on the cross: it is finished. I think that is the most powerful words you ever heard from the cross. And this is the reason why we are all here today, is because of the accomplished work of Christ. So what I want to talk about today is, what do you do with the completed work of Christ? And this is not the first time you all have heard about it is finished. We have a pastor that goes in depth with many of these studies. So I'm going to talk about, what do we do with the completed work? Well, first, you believe it. Everyone has heard it, but hearing it and knowing it and believing it is completely different. So we maybe have been in church for over 25 years, and we would have watched the Passion of the Christ, but it's only when we believe what Jesus accomplished on the cross, is what he accomplished becomes ours, that victory. When Jesus died, nothing changed around. Like today, the world is still chaotic. It's difficult. We're going through a lot of suffering. But what did Jesus actually do? Is that's what you find in Hebrews 2:10. It says, in bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. So he is calling sons and daughters into his glory. And the only way we can do that is believing in the finished work of Jesus. So the second thing that we can do is proclaim it. See, every other religion or cult in this world gets you to do something to work yourself into heaven. But it is the gospel alone that says it is finished, that you don't have to do anything. You just have to believe in him and put your faith in him. So through all that difficulty or whatever you're going through, is to believe in the finished work of Christ and to have faith in what he accomplished for you. You have that victory. So, and the lastly, what I want to say is, you rejoice in it. We can't add to what God has already completed. And today there are so many people who are trying to add to it. So Christ finished, we haven't, but with him, we will. Thank you.
Dying words of Jesus: Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. See, Jesus, even until death, had full and utter assurance of the mission of his mission here on earth. He knew the significance of this moment. He wasn't mad. Even unto death, he was in perfect relationship with the Father. This phrase, however, echoes back to the book of Psalms, just as some of his others did. So not only was Jesus fully trusting God the Father, but he was worshiping the Father until the end. Psalm 31, which is what Jesus is quoting here, is talking about the saving power of the Lord. Right before this phrase in the Psalms, it says, "For you are my strength," talking of the Lord. And right after it says, "You have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth." You see, in ancient rabbinical tradition, quoting a single part of the scripture was actually quoting the scripture in its whole. So this passage talks about the justice and righteousness. This psalm talks about the justice and righteousness that the Lord will deliver unto his people. See, Jesus' dying words on the cross were referencing the full and finished work that this act meant. In Psalms it says, "But as for me, I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me." Friends, as followers of Jesus, we're called to pick up our cross and follow him. And when we're talking about surrendering to Jesus, this surrender is modeled to us by our Savior hanging on the cross. We should be declaring the same things, followers of Jesus: "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And but as for me, I trust in you." So even unto death, our Savior models how we as his disciples are to act. Jesus is telling Father God, "I trust you in your goodness completely. These people, this plan that to beat death once and for all, to see you, Father, glorified, I trust it all. I commit my spirit into your hands." And then after that, he breathed his last.
As we prepare to receive from the Lord's table this morning, I first want to acknowledge every one of the speakers. They did an amazing job this morning. I know they were all nervous. And it doesn't help when you have all kinds of noises going off from within the congregation, but they did an amazing job. So shall we... Yeah. And another thing, that as I listen to each one of them speak and bring such an amazing, refreshing view of the seven sayings on the cross, I must confess that I was falling in love with Jesus all over again. To think of what he did for us. Isn't it just amazing? How he loves us. I would just picture myself like the beloved disciple, John, standing at the foot of the cross and looking at him as he was completely in control, but in absolute pain and agony, saying each one of those things. Because every one of those sayings had a meaning, had a purpose. And he said it for us to hear thousands and thousands of years later. Because it brings something to us. As I looked at the seven sayings on the cross once again and the implication for communion, what do these seven sayings mean for us today as we partake of the Lord's table? Oddly, the Lord took me back to the beginning of his ministry. And in the beginning of his ministry, in Matthew chapter 3, I believe it is, when John the Baptist was about to baptize Jesus, or when Jesus presented himself to be baptized by John, John said this. He tried to prevent Jesus from being baptized by him. He thought he was not worthy to baptize the Son of God. In fact, he said, "I'm not worthy to baptize you, let alone even untie the strap on your sandal. I'm not worthy of this." And Jesus said to him, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness." And for a long time, I was wondering, why did he say that to John when John prevented him from being baptized? Because Jesus had no sin, and his baptism was not a repentance of sin. You and I are baptized when we repent of our sin. What was the baptism of Jesus? And I believe it was a priestly baptism, because Jesus Christ was taking on a priestly duty, and he was going to function as a priest, because he is the high priest who presented his own sacrifice to heaven on the cross. And remember, Jesus was of the tribe of Judah and not Levi. John the Baptist was a Levite, a son of a priest, and he had all the right to do this under the law. What was Jesus showing them? He was saying, I have come under the law. Yes, I am the Son of God. I am God. As Janidu showed us, he is the Logos, the Word of God that was there in the beginning. And yet, he came under the law to fulfill the law and the prophets. The Bible, the Old Testament has something like 500, close to or roughly 500 prophecies about Jesus. And at his first coming, he fulfilled 300 of those prophecies. That itself is an absolute miracle and proof that he is the Messiah. You say, what about the balance? Well, those are going to be fulfilled at his second coming. And on the cross and at his crucifixion, he fulfilled 28 of those prophecies. And of the seven words that we heard today, four of them, as was clearly outlined by the speakers, and one of the things is they have done their research beautifully. Very proud of you guys. Is that they... Yeah, go ahead. Out of those seven words, four were prophecies. Fulfillment of prophecies. In fact, as John said when he started, Father, forgive them. It is a fulfillment of Psalm 53, verse 15, where the Bible says he will intercede for the transgressors. When we spoke about Psalm 22, verse 1, Ajit was speaking about, my God, why have you forsaken me? That is a fulfillment of a prophecy. We heard that as well. We heard Greg finish with, into your hands I commit my spirit. That again is Psalm 31, verse 5. And we heard from Maria, it is finished. And Psalm 22, verse 31, the Bible says, he has done this. And in Hebrew, it literally means, for it is finished. What is this all about? I think the Sunday school children are coming to show me what they have done. But last Sunday, one was walking up the aisle to claim his bride. Okay? I mean, these guys, I don't know what they're teaching in Sunday school, but yeah. He was coming up the aisle to say, my Sophie is not in church. And his parents intercepted him and took him back in time, but he got me after church and said, where is my Sophie? So, yeah, they do those things. Well, what we see here is that Jesus meticulously, to the letter, every word, completely fulfilled the law and the prophets. And we heard this morning, completely. And it is, why did he do all this? So that you and I, as we heard, even as Ajit shared, as you and I can have access into the presence of God, we can have access to the mercy seat, we can have access to the throne of grace. Under the Old Testament, it was the high priest once a year who had access to the Holy of Holies. But as Jesus fulfilled the law, every one of us, as his royal priesthood, has access into that presence, and the cup and the bread that we partake in the morning is a reminder of the access you have to the throne of grace. That is what it is. He did it all so we can have that access. And I believe it is a crime when the people of God stand afar thinking, I am not worthy of this or good enough, and beat themselves down when we heard Jesus said, it is finished. It is accomplished. So if you are here this morning and you are feeling lonely and insecure, isolated and unloved and uncared for, I want you to understand he was forsaken so that you don't have to be forsaken. And as the Bible says, even if your mother and father forget you, I will not. He will never leave you nor forsake you. If you are here this morning and you feel far from God, if you feel that you have no relationship with God, if you feel that you don't know this God, understand this, that he died for you so that you can come to the Father and know him. All this he did for you. If you're feeling guilty and condemned, unclean and sinful and unworthy, know in heaven, in the court of heaven, you have a rap sheet. And it's probably pretty long, some longer for others than, you know. You have a long rap sheet there. And across it is written the word guilty. And your accuser stands before the court of heaven, pointing his finger at you and saying, he is guilty. But know this, when Jesus fulfilled the law and the prophets to the letter and died on the cross and shed his blood, and when he walked into heaven 2,000 years ago and he entered into the gates of heaven and the angels cried out, who is this who's approaching the ancient gates? Psalm 24. Who is this who approaches the ancient gates? Who has the right? Who dares to come and knock on the ancient gates? And then they look and realize it is the King of Glory. And then the angel host cries out, it is the King of Glory, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord who has conquered in battle by his blood, is the one who stands at the gates of heaven, the ancient gates, and enters in. And as John says, he sees a lamb as if it was slain sitting in the throne room of God. Today, he doesn't sit completely healed of his scars and wounds. He sits in heaven with nail-scarred hands, a pierced side, and nails in his feet. Why? Because whenever the accuser of the brethren comes to him and says, they are guilty, he says, Father, look at my hands. I did it for them. I did it for them. My blood has declared them clean. And across your rap sheet in the throne room of heaven, in the courts of heaven, is written in blood, he is not guilty. Lord, our Lord did this all for us. So when we partake of communion, I want to ask those who are distributing the cup and the bread to come and take it and give it to you. I want us to spend a few moments contemplating the amazing love of Jesus Christ. And I pray and I hope as you listen to every word that was spoken today, as you contemplate what Jesus did for you on the cross, that you will leave this place understanding that he still sits in the throne room of heaven and intercedes for you. As you take the cup and the bread, keep it in your hand, and we will partake of it together. Shall we stand up, church? And as you're waiting for the cup and the bread to come, spend a few moments meditating on the love of Jesus for you. If your love for him has grown cold, I want you to think about the disciples on the road to Emmaus. They couldn't understand what had happened. They were confused. It was soon after the crucifixion. It was on the third day. They were confused. They were sad. And Jesus walks by their side and they can't even see who he is. And then he comes to their home and he breaks bread with them. And the moment he breaks bread, the Bible says their hearts were warmed. I pray that as you and I partake of this bread, that it will not be another ritual we do on Good Friday or what we do in church, but it will be something that warms your heart with the love of Jesus Christ. That your passion for him, if it has grown cold, will today be ignited by the fire of his love, by the power of his Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray today, Father, as we prepare to partake of your table, the table that you prepared for us. Lord, as David said, you prepare a table for me before my enemies. Lord, you prepared that table for us by climbing up on a cross and being crucified on the cross. You prepared this table for us. Lord, I pray, Father, today as we partake of the bread and the cup, Lord, help us to understand that we are sitting with you at this table. And Lord, let us come forward and receive from you the grace and mercy we need. Let us come forward and receive from you the love that was poured out on Calvary. Let it flow into our hearts. Lord, I pray we'll receive from you the power of the cross to set us free from the curse of sin and death. The power of the cross to heal us. Lord, heal our minds. Heal our bodies. To heal us, O God. For your word says that by your stripes we are healed. Lord, I pray that we will receive from your table, this table you prepared for us. Lord, let us receive the breaking of the curse. Oppression and darkness and curse be broken. For when you climbed on that cross, O God, you became a curse for us. Oh, the love of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your amazing love that welcomes us into your presence. Father, I pray that we will not waste any of this what you have done for us. But I pray, O God, that the Lamb of God will receive the full reward of his suffering in and through our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's partake together, church. We're going to pray and close.
Now, we thank you, Lord, that at the moment of our biggest failure, that you came up with a plan to save us, to draw us back to you. That when the door slammed shut in our face, you opened it. And Father, I pray that the knowledge of our salvation, the joy of our salvation, Lord, that that would be the helmet, Lord, that we wear. Lord, that it protects our minds from doubt, depression, Lord, from despair. Father, that, Lord, it gives us the knowledge of who we are in you. And Father, I pray that as we go out today, Lord, that we would carry that knowledge of our salvation, that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Lord, that despite difficulties, despite the challenges that we face, Lord, that the knowledge of our salvation is why we can say that we have known the goodness of God in the land of the living. So I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
My reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing. Been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything salvation and this hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing. Jesus is here. To God be the glory. decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning.
Bless you, church. I hope you have an awesome Good Friday with the rest of the day. Just a quick announcement. We are having Easter Sunday service from 8:30 to 10 at Nugiego Auditorium. That's in Gasaba Junction. We'll send the location on the group as well so that you have the details with you. So it's an outreach service, so make sure that you bring a friend, bring a loved one, bring a family member who you know will be impacted by what God has done on that day. So yeah, see you Sunday 8:30 at Nugiegoda Auditorium. Amen. God bless you, church.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided.